Few great historical figures are presented as the embodiment of evil, among which is Catherine de Medici. The legend of her wickedness, which reached its height in the 19th century, embraced a great variety of disagreeable qualities. She's been depicted, among other things, as cold, cruel, calculating, treacherous, and evil. She was a monster of selfish ambition who sacrificed her children, her adopted country, her principles, if she had any, and all who stayed in her way to the satisfaction of her all-consuming desire of power. Thus, she was fully prepared to commit any crime. Naturally, there are many variations of her life story, some moderate, other pure fiction. Even today, the widespread credence and support of these stories is continued, not only by the media, but even by some historians. That's right, today we'll be debunking some centuries-spread rumors about Catherine de Medici. But before we continue, let us know in the comments below, do you know what was the age gap between Henri II and his mistress Diane de Poitiers? The base of this myth is a fact that involves Jeanne d'Albert, the Queen of Navarre, who wasn't a big fan of Catherine. France in the 1500s was a place of constant civil war between Catholics and Protestants. Jeanne d'Albret fiercely defended the Protestants' cause in France and declared it the official religion of her kingdom, much to the displeasure of Catherine, a strict Catholic. Catherine viewed the never-ending conflict as a significant threat to the stability of the realm. She advocated religious tolerance towards the Huguenots and, above all, wanted to secure the supremacy and longevity of the Valois dynasty. As part of her peacemaking efforts, Catherine negotiated with Jeanne d'Albret to arrange a marriage between their children, Margaret of Valois and Henri of Navarre. The two women had a tense relationship, with Jeanne writing that Catherine only mocks me and reported the contrary of what I have said to her in order that my friends will blame me. Jeanne reluctantly agreed to the match, and a marriage was arranged between her son Henri and Catherine's daughter, the Princess Marguerite. 2 months before the strategic wedding, Jeanne d'Albret died suddenly, along with all her doubts about the marriage. Many of the Protestants whose religion she championed during her lifetime believed the death to be murder and pointed to Catherine as the prime suspect. The choice of weapon? A pair of poisoned leather gloves. When Catherine de Medici came to France by way of marriage, she brought with her several trends from her native Florence, including beauty rituals. Italy in the 16th century was a fragrant place where perfume was used to scent skin as well as all articles of clothing. She promptly introduced perfumed gloves or sweet gloves to the French court, where men and women wore them as the ultimate emblem of prestige. But although her sweet gloves became popular in court and throughout France, Queen Catherine was never truly accepted by the French people she ruled over, who viewed her as a manipulative foreigner with a passion for the dark arts. The French already distrusted Queen Catherine, and the death of her known enemy Jeanne d'Albret only added fuel to the fire. Protestants in particular were quick to accuse Catherine of the death of their preeminent champion. One rumor that began to circulate was that Queen Catherine had murdered d'Albret with a pair of poison gloves. Poison was a common killer in France at this time, and the rise of the French school of poisoners is said to have inspired as many as 30,000 poisoners by 1572. After three religious civil wars in a period of 10 years and constant assassination attempts on leaders of both religions, the death of a Protestant queen was assumed to be unnatural. After all, the outspoken Queen of Navarre had been viewed by Catholics as a threat in need of silencing for some time. Furthermore, gloves were a common gift of the royal court, valued not only for their precious materials but also for their symbolism. Gifted gloves, especially coming from a queen, conveyed a sentiment of loyalty and affection. Even though the discord between the two women was well known throughout France, many Protestants assumed that Queen Catherine would surely have sent a pair of sweet gloves to the mother of her son's betrothed. It would have been rude not to. The theory of Jeanne d'Albret's death by poisoned gloves has since been discredited by modern historians, who consider it much more likely that d'Albret succumbed to tuberculosis. But the intrigue of the myth continues to prosper. It seems that we are more willingly to believe a rumor about gloves infused with poison than we are to accept the mundane reality of a common malady. During the 16th century, a large number of Italian immigrants occupied France, and many were treated as manipulators, poisoners, and thought to be sexually deviant because of their culture. Catherine de Medici's sexual deviance due to her gender and culture would furthermore work against her, as stereotypes emerged to describe her sexual exploitation of her ladies-in-waiting, known as the Flying Squadron. Medici's court of sexual women was largely made believable because of the image of women as sexual manipulators and as sexually voracious. It was believed that Medici ordered these women to seduce influential nobles noblemen, and that some of these women were eventually involved in scandals around poisoning, adultery and incest. For example, poisoning was traditionally viewed as a female crime because of a woman's lack of physical strength and because of her responsibilities for preparing food and drinks. Many of the rumors began because power and authority was threatened, at least in the eyes of the parliamentaries, by the political preeminence of Catherine de Medici and the increasingly public role of the women of her household. These rumors were based solely on stereotypes attributed to women, but they became believable in time and played a vital role in shaping the image of these women and, most importantly, the image of Catherine. Another accusation that has persisted in darkening Catherine's name is that of her practicing black magic. In an anonymously published, widely read pamphlet from 1576, Catherine's ascension to the regency of France was credited to her practice of witchcraft. This pamphlet, titled Marvellous Discourse on the Life, Actions and Deportment of Catherine de Medici, Queen Mother, claimed, through the wave of her wand and bewitching potion, she had changed us into wild beasts and torn out our humanity. There is no evidence to suggest that Catherine practiced magic, though it is likely that the accusation sprang from her relationship with the famed physician and seer Nostradamus. She had summoned him to court after reading his almanacs from 1555. In which he referenced potential threats to the royal family. Later, she gave him a position as Charles IX physician in ordinary. She was also passionately interested in astronomy and astrology, and her Italian origin didn't help her with the rumors, since at that time Italians were known for being famous poisoners. Due to this, another legend was born, that the cabinets at her Blois palace were for Catherine's poison style. The room in question holds 237 small cabinets, hidden in the beautiful woodwork. The room was in fact associated with Catherine de Medici, and she was certainly suspected of some heinous poison-related crimes. But historians believe that the cabinets were much more likely to have held small art objects or confidential papers, not a poison collection. The first important thing we need to establish here is that 16th century historians felt compelled not to understand the event, but to plant the blame for it. This might have been fixed on the Duc de Guise or even on the king, but since historians were working with polemical writings of Protestant pamphlets who laid on Catherine all the blame for the massacre, the scapegoat for everything, with few exceptions, has always been Catherine. Now, why Protestants pamphleteers put the blame on her? Their anger towards her was their driving force. In the pamphlets, they explicitly state their discontent that Catherine reportedly have read their denunciations with interest but relative unconcern, which made them feel rejected and mistreated. However, there is no direct evidence that she orchestrated or was involved with the massacre. In fact, it is a historically known fact that at the first, Catherine de Medici was inclined to favor the Protestants. To defend the Catholic cause, the Duc de Guise, alongside supporters, formed the so-called Triumvirate opposed to the policy of concessions which Catherine de Medici attempted to inaugurate in favor of the Protestants, and therefore the conciliation policy of Catherine de Medici was defeated. As part of her peacemaking efforts, Catherine negotiated with Jeanne d'Albret, the Protestant Queen of Navarre and widow of Antoine de Bourbon, to arrange a marriage between their children, Margaret of Valois and Henri of Navarre.
The nuptials went ahead with the ceremony on August 18th with deadly consequences.
The circumstances of what happened next are subject to much debate, but historians generally agree that the crisis began on August 22nd when an assassin wounded but failed to kill Coligny. Fearful of Huguenots' reprisal, the Catholic faction took preemptive action, murdering the injured Coligny and sparking a wave of violence that quickly spiraled out of control. Catholics targeted Huguenots, easily distinguished by their black and white clothing in the streets, indiscriminately killing men, women and children. The bloodshed spread beyond Paris to the French provinces, continuing for days, if not weeks. Estimates of the death toll vary widely, from 2,000 to 70,000. Contemporary historians place the number of deaths in Paris alone at about 3,000 people. Though historians have no concrete evidence of Catherine's involvement in the assassinations that triggered the massacre, the Medici queen has historically borne the lion's share of the blame. Accusers argue that she planned the wedding as a way of luring Protestants to their deaths, conspiring with the Guises and other Catholics to plot the annihilation of their enemies. Regardless of Catherine's role or lack of thereof in the massacre, her name is irrevocably linked with the bloodshed, a fact that contributed to her later vilification as the Serpent Queen and the Black Queen. The Queen Mother's association with the deaths of thousands of innocents cemented her reputation as a villain. Catherine de Medici was a passionate ruler interested in politics and government, a fiercely protective mother, and strong leader of the French monarchy during a time of intense political turmoil. If you stayed by the end of the video and you enjoyed our content, make sure to subscribe so you won't miss out any new historical video. If you want to learn the answer of the question in the beginning of the video, do you know what was the age gap between Henri II and his mistress Diane de Poitiers? Then check out our video dedicated to Diane right here. Thank you for watching.